This is Latif Saeed, and our topic for today is going to be on acid and bases. The topic of acid and bases is important simply because of the use to which acids and bases are being put into. And apart from that, if we look at us as human beings, I think there's no way we can do without using acid or bases. Talking about what we are using in the kitchen and our waste materials in the kitchens, in industries, in our clothing, in our electronics, in fruits and beverages, there is no way we can actually do without being in contact with acids. So that necessitates the need to know much about these two particular groups of compounds so that we can harness the enormous potentials that are inherent in the properties of this large set of compounds. So at the end of today's class, it is our aim that students will understand the concept of acids and bases. The properties of acids and bases should be properly distinguished. Different types of acids should be taught, and the basicity of acid, then the quantification in terms of the acidity and alkalinity, and the level of which the acid substances are acidic or alkaline. Then simple calculations can be done on pH and pOH. So if we look at acid as matter of introduction, acids have been used for a very long time. Example is in our vinegar. Vinegar is a fruit, and in the fruit we have juice. That juice inside that fruit is acidic solution, and that solution is used in food company. Today, as a result of study of the properties of what we are getting in vinegar, many products have been developed from acid. Examples are fertilizers, explosives, plastic, even computer circuit boards. There are many products that have been developed from acid. And again, in bases, likewise in acid, there have been, from time immemorial, many use of acid. The example is these Babylonians, where they made soap, or this local soap, black soap, using bases in wood ash. I think in Nigeria and in some other African countries, apart from the Middle East, they have been using it for a very long time. It is only civilization that is trying to erode that civilization from us, that technology from us, rather. Today, one of Canada's most important industries is the paper and pulp industry, and that industry got a very large amount of sodium hydroxide as a base. So sodium hydroxide is also used in the manufacture of soaps, detergents, there's a many other compounds. So we can see that all these examples of substances that are being made from acids and bases, they are very large group of compounds that we may not actually do without them in our daily lives. See soaps, detergents, and again in plastic, in explosives, in fertilizers, in motor vehicles, that is for acid. So we cannot actually do about them. That is why we need deep knowledge of acids and bases, and this particular lecture will provide the introduction to that concept. So to know the acids from the bases or from other compounds, there are some certain properties that need to be considered, that need to be looked for, so as to be able to, oh, this is acid, this is base, this is not acid, this is not base, this could be probably another substance. That is why we need to distinguish between these two substances. Sometimes we use taste to differentiate compounds. So in acid, acid tastes sour, Sour is not the same thing as bitter. It's not the same thing as sweet. It is not bitter. It's not sweet. It's just sour. Bitter is the opposite, directly opposite of sweet. So bases are bitter. If you feel the solution, the acids have no characteristic feel, but bases feel slippery. For chemical tests, if these two, the first two tests, I mean the taste and feel of solution, they are not that reliable because it's not appropriate to feel with your sense of feeling like fingers or palm or taste substances, because you don't know if the substances are poison. So in that case, we need some scientific test. So the first one, the simplest one we are going to do is on action on litmus paper. So if you have a wet blue litmus paper, we put it in acid, it turns to red. Then conversely, if you have a wet red litmus paper, it turns to blue color if it's been put in basis. So with metal that are both hydrogen in the electrochemical series, metal like calcium, like zinc, like magnesium, all those metals, they displace hydrogen during reaction, so they produce hydrogen gas, but in basis they do not react. So that's a very good test to differentiate between acid and basis. The reaction with CO2, it produces CO2 and basis do not react. So acid reacts with that, with carbonate, to produce CO2. So having known the properties of acid, so how do we define acid? Acid, there are many definitions of acid depending on what they have considered, because scientists, they have done much work when it comes to the study of acids and bases. Example of Humphrey Davy, Svante Arrhenius. There are many of them like that, but we are going to consider just maybe two or three of them to be able to just get the fact we want to get from the acid, because these are recent ones. All those old ones, they led to this recent one. So there's no point in talking about the old ones if this new one contained the information that have been disseminated in the old ones. So Arrhenius defined acids as a substance that dissociates in water to produce hydrogen ion. That is hydrogen ion, H+. So this, if you put acid in water, Arrhenius consider water as the solvent in this case. There are other scientists that do not consider only water as the solvent, but in this case, Arrhenius consider water. So now, if you put acid in water, there's going to be dissociation between the positive hydrogen and the negative, the non-metallic ion that are in the acid. So what Arrhenius was trying to tell us now is that all acid must contain hydrogen, and again base must contain hydroxyl ion. That is what Arrhenius was trying to consider in his own definition of acids and bases. So now, that one now led to the Brønsted-Lowry. That the two of them, they did their experiment. Brønsted did his own experiment separately from Lowry, but their findings are the same. That is why they put them together as Brønsted-Lowry. Brønsted and Lowry defined acid as a proton donor, white base as a proton acceptor. So in this case, they opened their own definition, not only water as a solvent, but anything can act as a solvent or a solute. Don't forget, we have talked about solvent and solute before, and that anything can act as solvent, anything can act as solute. So when we have something like this, as this definition, it means acid must donate proton, white base must accept proton. So if you have substance A and substance B like this, and one is acid, so definitely the other one must be a base. That is the own definition, Brønsted and Lowry. Their own is different from, let me say it's different. It's more encompassing than what Arrhenius said. Arrhenius used water as the solvent. So the base that produces lone pair of electrons, which accepts the proton for coordinate covalent bond formation. So what Bransfield-Lawrence trying to say is that when we have acid and bases reacting together, or let me say substance that acts as an acid or another substance that acts as a base. So when we have something like this, the two of them like this, that react together, one of them will produce their lone pair of electrons. That lone pair will now be shared between the two of them for that coordinate covalent bond to form. We have talked about coordinate covalent bond before. So it's the reaction between ammonia and HCl. So anyone that produces the lone pair of electrons in this case is the base. That is the concept of Bransfield-Lowry definition. So when we now have something like this, Arrhenius' definition ask another question. What happens to the water if we have acid dissolved in water and we have dissociation of acid in water according to Arrhenius? So what happened to the element of water? You see that water comes out as just ordinary water? Scientists say no. So that one now brought about another definition of acid as a substance that donates hydrogenium ion, the only positive ion when dissolved in water. So when we have something like this, water, we have this as an acid. When I dissolve them together, there's dissociation of between this and this, so we have chloride negative. So instead of the water to be in water form hydrogen ion, to be an hydrogen ion, the hydrogen ion now combine with water to form hydrogen ion. That is a more general definition, whether it is acid or not an acid. So whether it is water as a solvent or there is water inside, so there must be plenty of hydrogenium ion. So this is more of Bransfield-Lowry definition. We have this and this, as I've said before. So from those theories stated above, it is clear that we have something that must accept proton, another one must accept electron, and it is not necessary that water must be the solvent, as I've explained earlier. So this now takes us to the types of acid. So the first one is the mineral acid that we're going to consider. The mineral acid is just inorganic acid that are produced in a laboratory. Example, at H2SO4, as a tetral sulfate 6 acid. We have hydrochloric acid, we have phosphoric acid, H3PO4. We have HNO3, that is triazole nitrate 5. There are many examples of acid that are produced in a laboratory. The another large group is the organic acid that are those are naturally formed from plants. Examples are lactic acid that are formed from salmic, acetic acid from vinegar, citric acid from fruit. There are many ascorbic acid that is vitamin C from fruits also. So there are many examples of organic acid that are found from plants, majority plants or animals. So another concept we're going to consider now is strong acid and weak acid. Mineral acid can be strong, can be weak. Organic acid are always weak. We are still coming to that. So strong acid, what makes acid strong? Strong and concentration are not the same thing. Concentration is just the amount in water, or let's say amount in solvent. But strong has to do with strength. So this type of acid that have all this ion completely dissociated in aqueous solution, we have this now. This one, if we have water as our solvent, so we dissolve hydrogen chloride gas. So there is going to be dissolution inside water. There is going to be dissociation. This dissociation now produces this and this. So this is for example of a strong acid. So other examples are H2SO4, HBr, HR, HNO3, H3. This is perchlorate acid, this is hydrogen iodide, this is hydrogen bromide, H2SO4, this is HNO3. So there are also many examples. But all these examples of strong acid, they are always mineral acid. mineral acids are always very strong. So weak acid are the opposite of strong acid. They have their own ions dissociated but not complete dissociation, like 4% dissociation, 10% dissociation. Example is this ethanoic acid. this is an ethanoic acid. When dissolved in water, it's going to produce this and this. So we see that not all the hydrogen in the ethanoic acid are dissociated. So there's still plenty of hydrogen here. There's just one hydrogen that is dissociated. That is why this can react with this also to form this until equilibrium is established. That is why this sign is being put, the feasible reaction sign. So the idea now is anywhere we see partial azotinization like this, that acid is a weak acid. When we have a complete dissociation, that acid is a strong acid. But from experience, we discover that majority of all the organic acids are weak, but not all mineral acids are strong. Like this carbonic acid now, it's a mineral acid and it's weak. H2CO3. It's a weak acid, but it's a mineral acid. But there's no way you can see organic acid and strong. I've not seen. So strong acids have a high concentration of hydrogen ions and have high pH, so that their solution are good conductors of electricity. We are still coming to conductor of electricity, and they react quickly with metals, oxide of metals and carbonates of metals. Weak acids, on the other hand, produce few hydrogen ions, like we have said. They have high pH, more than the strong acid. We are still coming to quantitative assessment or evaluation of acidity. So a strong base, when dissolved in water, the lattice breakup, that is, I mean, dissociation, to produce ions. But if they produce large quantity of that and there's complete dissociation, then we have a strong base. They have high pH. Example are this sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide. The otherwise called alkali, they are always very soluble in water because they soluble. That is why they dissociate in water to form hydroxy. So a weak base or a weak alkali, so that's just as ammonia, produces fewer hydroxide ions when it dissolves in water than a strong soluble base of the same concentration. That's if you have the same concentration of the two bases, one is strong, one is weak. So one will produce more hydrogen ion, the other will produce fewer hydrogen of the same, hydrogen ion of the same concentration. It's only partially ionized and it has a lower pH, but still above 7. Because in the pH meter that we are going to see later, after 7, like 8, 9, 10, up to 14, there is alkalinity. Then less than 7, there is acidity. That 7 is the neutral. So we are still going to see when we do some calculations. Example is ammonia. That's an example of strong base, weak base rather, because it produces only few hydrogen molecules in water. So let's talk about basicity of acid. Basicity is just a term that used to describe the number of replaceable hydrogen ion in the solution of the acid. So if we dissolve acid in water, there's going to be dissociation. Fine. But how, to what extent do they dissociate? If they dissociate very largely, then the basicity will be different from if you dissociate small. So it depends on the number of hydrogen that are being replaced when there is reaction or when there is no reaction. So this is obtained by considering the dissociation equation of the acid. So like we have here now, this dissociation equation, we have hydrogen plus and Cl minus. So because of we have only one hydrogen here, that is monobasic. If we have H2SO4, so far we can have this. If you can write this now, we have this. It's going to be dibasic. We are going to see this HNO3, we are going to see monobasic. So it is not all the time that we have something like that. If like here now, in H, like the dissociation equation of this place now. So ordinarily, if we don't know, if we don't write this dissociation equation, we may be thinking this is tetrabasic, but it's not. Is only monobasic because it's only this hydrogen that can be replaced. This one is theoretically in that they cannot be replaced. Yeah, inside they cannot be replaced inside. So another concept is the concept of indicators, because we said we can distinguish between acid and bases by their taste, by their feel of solution. But it's not scientific and it's very dangerous to check the nature of substances with taste. So scientists, they don't do like that. So what they do is they have devised some other ways of some other safer ways of doing that. So that first one is the use of indicators. Indicators are substances that change in color when they contact with an acid or a base. So that will now give us the sense of is it acid or is it base, depending on the color of indicators. So if we look at this now, there is a table that shows the color of each of the indicator in acidic solution and base. Like low litmus, now if you put it in acid, it becomes red. If you put a red litmus, it becomes blue litmus is still blue in alkaline, but if you put a red litmus in alkaline, it becomes blue. So material is red in acid, it was yellow in base. When material is pink in acid, it's yellow in base. For after then is colorless in acid and it's pink in base. This particular table should be understood, because there are some questions that used to come out from it. Even it is useful during practical chemistry. These indicators test chemists, test scientists rather, whether a substance is acidic or alkaline. But it doesn't tell us how acidic, I mean the strength of the acid. So in that case, we are going to consider what is called a universal indicator, that is the combination of all other indicators that are being used. So if we have universal indicators, we put them in either acid or a base, there is going to be color change. That color change is matched with what is called the pH scale. This is the pH scale. So that pH scale is matched with this. So any color that perfectly match this indicates the pH, that is the level of acid. If it's like 3 now, so that is if the color is like this dirty brown, that is 3. If it's this purple, let me just around 14, very basic. And if it's like this, is 7, that is neutral, that means it's water. So this is a pH scale that used to distinguish between acid and bases using universal indicator, because universal indicator, they contain some other indicators that are dissolved together, like material, like phenolphthalein, like methionine, like bromothymol blue, like litmus, the red and the blue. So there are many substances that have been put together as a universal indicator. So anyone that respond to that change is what is being matched to this pH scale, and that gives us the idea of our acid or how basic the substance are. Apart from using the pH scale, if you want to get the numerical evaluation, the qualitative description of how strong an acid is, we use what is called a pH meter. That apart from pH scale, we use what is called this mathematics. The mathematics tells us what we have, because it relates hydrogen ion concentration to the pH. So for basic solution, we have something like this. Also pH and pOH, addition of the two of them is equal to 14. Then we have the concentration of acids and bases to be equal to 14. So these are concentrations. This square bracket, the means concentrations. This H3O plus is hydrogen ion. It can be taken as hydrogen ion, because it is when hydrogen ion dissolves in water that we have this. So water does not have any contribution to the acid. So these are the examples. We can calculate the pH of the solution of 2 molar acetic acid
solution whose this concentration is equal to this. So this is concentration that we want to consider. Even from this now, we can see that it's a very weak acid. Apart from this name, the acetic acid that we know, very weak acid, we can get it from this concentration, these values. 2 molar is the concentration of the acid, but from the acid we have just 0.006 molar hydrogen ions. This is very weak. So if we have this, I'll put it in the solution. And this formula, we are going to see that our pH is 2.22. Sorry, I said it's very weak. No, it's not very weak. It's very strong. Sorry, very strong. It's 2.22 is a very strong acid. Common blood has a pH of 7.3, almost neutral. Calculate that value. H3 0. So if we look at this value now, since that 10 to the power of minus 3, that we get 0.22, then we look at this 5 to the power of minus 8. You can see that they are very far. So hydrogen ion concentration is very small in the blood. That is why the pH is almost neutral, 7.3. So all these, they are not all these concentrations that I'm doing, they are not actually needed, but just to give you the sense of the understanding of numbers. If you see number, you know if you are right or wrong. So that is just what we're going to do for today. But before we go, let us do some reviews of what we have taught. Acids are proton donors, Y bases are proton acceptors. And again, we have organic acid, amino acid as the two broad types of acids that we have. We have strong acids or bases that dissociate completely, while weak acids or bases dissociate partially in water. The indicators are used to indicate acidity. We have talked about that. And pH is the mathematical determination of the concentration of hydrogen ions. So thank you for listening to this lecture. We are going to consider salt in our next class. Stay tuned and enjoy your day. Don't forget to share and like our videos. Thank you for listening. God bless you. Really good.